I've heard there are a lot of hormonal medications taken before extracting eggs for freezing and for IVF. Do both have side effects in the long run? Is the process of egg retrieval and embryo transfer a painful procedure? What are constant injections given? Why are constant injections given throughout an IVF treatment? And are there as many injections for IUI and egg freezing as well?
Like I was telling earlier, the whole agenda or the whole purpose of stimulating is to make sure that you end up getting more number of eggs. There are tablets to stimulate, but then when tablets are given to stimulate, they are not able to produce more number of eggs. They produce like say one or two or sometimes three eggs. But in especially in a procedure like IVF and all, we are talking about say 10, 15 eggs. So when you are stimulating for 10, 15 eggs, the only way that we can actually stimulate this much number of eggs are giving them hormones. Now these hormones are the actual hormones that are inside our body. So we are giving them in a slightly higher dose, and we are giving so that more number of eggs are formed. Unfortunately, these hormones come only as injectables. So that is the whole reason that when we are giving you daily injections, these are all no other way other than injections.
And it is slightly painful.
Yeah, definitely. I think
it is painful.
I wouldn't say that the process of an IVF is an easy process. That is something that I think we should accept, because I remember people being surprised that IVF. There's no doubt, IVF is one of the most stressful procedures that anybody can go through. The way that it goes, the daily injections, the stress of waiting that 15 days, taking those painful injections, to know your results. So it is not an easy procedure. But then that is probably the only way that we can do it at this point of time.
Yes.
There is a future that is coming. They're saying about an injection that has an effect of 6-7 days, so that you can just have one injection for 7 days. But I think all those things are like just
much
in the pipeline, and probably it will come in later. So unfortunately, yes, injectables are the only way that we can give to produce more number of eggs. And the reason that we need more number of eggs is so that we can make more number of embryos. We have more number of embryos, we have more number of attempts so that they can become pregnant. Like you have so many embryos, at least one of those embryos will catch and make them pregnant. So that is the whole idea, that we try to produce more number of eggs. Now the question of whether stimulating of these ovaries are going to cause any harm to the patient is an important question that a lot of people ask. Technically or medically, if you look at it, only if you stimulate them every month for almost a year, give the medications for every month of more than a year and things like that, it's only when you're going to actually have a problem, which very rarely happens. We generally always end up, when you do an IVF, when you do a repeat IVF, we always do it only after 3 months.
After three months.
So all those things are extremely rare scenarios. Now, when you look at side effects, there are two main side effects that we always talk about in IVF, which are common, which is an actual side effect. One is having more number of eggs. See, when I'm looking at, I'm trying to make 10 to 15 eggs. Okay, now there will be certain patients who are with, like PCOD patients, who I'm only trying to make 10 to 15 eggs, but then when they suddenly come up, they come up with some 30 eggs, 40 eggs.
What happens then?
So there is a syndrome called as ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome, which is a little difficult scenario where they'll end up having fluid that is accumulated in the tummy, and they'll have breathing difficulty and all those. There's a complication of, and unfortunately, it's a treatment-related complication. That is, if you're not done the treatment, the patient wouldn't have had that complication. But then, this is what we get sometimes in that bargain. We want to produce more number of eggs, we give you these medications, and instead of making few, you end up making
a lot more.
But then, if you're not given those medications, you wouldn't have made eggs.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So, it is something that we have to. So that's why in patients who are hyper responders, or these are people who respond very much, we have to give medications accordingly. We give them the dose of medications, all those things. We give them very low medications, we monitor them more frequently and things like that. We don't transfer the embryos. We freeze their embryos, make their body normal, and after 2 or 3 months only we transfer those embryos so that the patient is okay. Now the second complication, obviously the most common or accidental complication, is multiple pregnancy. Because generally what happens is, in a little older patients or difficult patients, we always end up putting 2 or 3 embryos. Now we put 2 or 3 embryos not to make that 2 or 3 embryos to catch. We assume that when you put 2 or 3 embryos, at least one of them will catch. So there's a 70% chance of one embryo to catch. There's a 20% chance that two will catch. and there's a less than 5% chance that all three will catch. So when we are doing, and you should say if 50% of the time they get pregnant, see I'm saying if they get pregnant within 40-50% of the time, of that 50%, 70% will have only singleton. So at least the whole idea for us at that point of time is to make sure at least that we transfer, they have at least one child at one point. But then that there is that risk of having two embryos and having twins and triplets. Yeah. So these two are the basic, otherwise complications that are associated, like say if you're looking at cancer related to, see now a lot of this, there is this apprehension in a lot of people that you multiple, yes, multiple stimulations for a very long time consistently can have some form of
like cancer. What is the worst case scenario?
Like we have seen these ovarian cancers and all that come. But I would always say that, see, you never know whether it is specifically because of this treatment. They probably would have had that small factor that would have actually
aggravated it?
Yeah, probably this just would have aggravated it.
Okay.
It's just like a trigger. This would have triggered that cancer in those patients, like patients with breast. A lot of people are worried about, because now this is going to cause high levels of estrogen in the body.
Yes.
More number of eggs will produce more number of more amount of. Now this estrogen can have some kind of effect on certain breast masses, and can, there are certain cancers which are related to breast, like related to estrogen content, like any estrogen content might probably stimulate them. So but then the possibility of all these things are there, but extremely rare. But like I said, when you're talking about 1-2% or 3% possibility of this happening, you should realize that 97-98% of the time is an only opportunity for you to have a child. So when we are actually going in that bargain of what to choose or
what's
not to choose,
yeah,
what is important for you at that point of time, you'll have to decide.
Yeah.
And say that yes, that risk factor is there, but since it's extremely less, we take that factor and then go ahead with the treatment.
But in the long run, post-pregnancy
generally it should not have, generally we've not
does
had
it
any
affect any part of the body organs,
see,
and,
now,
because of so much of injections?
No, generally no, but what, see, what we end up seeing is a lot of people become a little, like I say, they put on, basically it's because of the water retention. A lot of people say they made them because of the hormones, they made them fat.
Yes.
But more than actually the hormones making the fat, initially it's the water retention, and their extreme rest, caring, eat well. It's probably, rather than all that, it is
extreme
basic
precautions.
Precautions are probably making them put on weight rather than the treatment per se.
Yes.
Yes, if at all there are some effect of the injections or the water retention because of the injections that they're taking. It's only when you're taking, and it will go within.
Yeah, I've heard about that.
Weight gain, losing hair. So that, for a particular point of time, see, even a pregnancy will have all these
yes.
issues. See, it is all these fluctuations in
yeah.
hormones and high hormone levels, all those things will cause losing of hair, and all those things are very common, and even in pregnancy.
Yeah.
So just like that, this fluctuation of hormones can cause all those issues, but they are not like, see, again, we look at, again, when you're kind of balancing the bargain of what we are going to achieve and what we are going to go through or what we are going to achieve. So we know that these possibilities are small possibilities are there, but there's nothing that is very harmful. Like I said, two main complications is, one is hyperstimulation, and that rest of the things are all very, very small, minuscule things which can happen, cannot happen. But then what happens is, a lot of times people find, when it fails, people find it so traumatic. Now, a lot of people, once, because they expected so much out of the treatment, they were expecting 100% result, and they are, when they don't get the result, the whole world goes upside down. So at that point of time, they blame the
yeah.
emotional trauma that like I said, why it is important for you to understand your result is because a lot of these people, once they get negative, they get just, they kind of go cocoon themselves, they don't come out for treatment, they go away. Then you know that sometimes it'll be a simple case, but just that they did not get pregnant the first time. But then they should accept it, and they have to come back and probably do the treatment again. But what would happen in this group of patients, no? They'll get so dejected, they'll go away, they'll come back after several years.
Mm.
And we've lost out on good time where we could actually do the treatment.
Try again.
And when they come at that point of time, the egg is gone. So now the results will be much lesser than what
it was
earlier. So
What is the maximum attempt they can have?
We have had patients who have done some 10 times and all. Okay.
10
IVF? 10 IVFs and all. So you had patients who have done 10 IVFs. Sometimes we reach a point wherein we tell the patient, like, I think it's high time that we stop the treatment because we know that. But some people are so persuasive that they still want to continue. They want to give that try. They want to see. I think one of the biggest strengths whenever we look for a fertility treatment, they want to come back to you even when it is negative, I feel, then you have been able to succeed or probably get the correct message across.